Hello? Hello, can anyone hear me?
Yes, I can hear
Okay. I think we'll just have to wait a little while.
you. Good morning, Samuel.
Yeah, good morning, Tibi. How are you today?
Very fine, thank you.
Yeah. Okay, so it's time to begin, but I think our numbers are still low. So I think we'll just wait, give them 5 minutes or 10 minutes before we start.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah, good morning, William. Good morning, Colenus. Good morning, Chidiberi. Good morning, Vivian. I think we should be getting ready to start the presentation.
Yeah. Okay, so we haven't seen your performance and efficiency guys this morning. I don't know if anybody knows why they're not here now.
Yeah, I think you can make progress because of the time.
Yeah. All right. Okay, so let's go ahead and share the screen. Okay, good morning, everyone. Once again, you're welcome to another session of our gas turbine performance engineering training. Today, I'll be talking about power augmentation of industrial gas turbines. Okay, so there's a whole lot to talk about today, but unfortunately, I have a limited time. So sometimes I'll be fast, sometimes I'll be slow. If I'm too fast, you let me know. If I'm too slow, I'll obviously want to ramp up. And so because of the limited amount of time, I will just be concentrating on the mechanical chillers. Okay, and as we go on, you'd kind of understand why I'll be doing that. So let's begin. Okay, so as we all know, the gas turbine is a constant volumetric flow machine, and obviously you have a constant flow in the compressor. And if you apply the ideal gas equation to the flow in the compressor, when there's an increase in the temperature and for a fixed pressure, atmospheric pressure of air, you have a reduction in the density of air to compensate for the increase in temperature, which is the case at the inlet of your compressor. So what that implies is that if there is a reduction in the density of air coming into the compressor, you remember it's a fixed volume flow device. So you need to have a compensation in the mass flow rates. So if you have a drop in density for a fixed volume device, which is your compressor, you'd have a reduction in the mass flow rate through your compressor. So this is just the theory behind, you know, reduction of mass flow as ambient temperature increases. This is just the theory behind it, basically. So ideally, if we could think about it, it's the reduction in mass flow has a dominant effect on the power output. And so as you move higher in ambient temperature, you suffer this, and it obviously have a dominant effect on your power output. So ideally, we would probably want the compressor to be a variable geometry, and something that had been looked at, right? But we're not there yet, basically. So what this implies is that for gas turbines operating in climatic conditions with high ambient temperature, they suffer a deviation from the ISO conditions. Okay, so if you've got a gas turbine rated at 100 megawatts at ISO, you bring it down to Nigeria in our case, it's not going to give you 100 megawatts, you know, and most times you just have to derate the engine. Or if for the purpose of application, you need 100 megawatts, you'd have to go for a bigger gas turbine, basically. And this is a major effect on, it has a major effect on performance and the cost, capital cost of what is required. But then again, it's nature, basically. It's what it is, unfortunately for us. So you can see the effect of increasing compressor inlet temperatures or ambient temperatures. You can see it's in degree Fahrenheit and it's in degree C. You notice all this following, you notice a drop in your output as temperature, ambient temperature increases. You notice an increase in your heat rate. You notice a reduction in heat consumption, an increase in the exhaust flow. Okay, a reduction in exhaust mass flow rate. So if you look at the compressor map, and we've talked about compressor map a lot, and I'm sure by now you know how important it is. So basically, if you look at the compressor map, you have your surge margin, you have your running line. Okay, so basically the gas is going to operate along this line, basically, and it's the gas turbine will always find the stable points to operate at, where all the components are matched, where all the compatibility are satisfied, flow compatibility, speed compatibility. So if you've got an increase, you have a gas turbine operating in a less ISO condition, this is, you have your non-dimensional speed lines here, you have your temperature ratio lines. Okay, so basically, if there is an increase in the ambient temperature, the operations on the compressor map moves towards this point, you know, basically. So what this implies is that you have a reduction in the pressure ratio, a reduction in the non-dimensional mass flow. And you can see at this point, you can see that there is quite some distance away from the surge margin. So basically, the hotter you operate, the hotter the inlets of your compressor is, the closer you get to your surge margin. So you're going to be moving along this line because you have a reduction in non-dimensional mass flow, basically. So this is what you likely see in your gas turbine performance when you're operating at a higher ambient temperature. Okay, so that's obviously an issue. We do not want that from a performance point of view, but nature is actually making us operate at those conditions. So the question now is, are there solutions around this challenge? Thank God there's a solution around it, and it's called power augmentation, okay? So basically, you can recover the loss of power as a result of the effect of high ambient or high compressor inlet conditions with some of these, the following techniques. You could inject steam or water at the inlet of the compressor, or actually in the combustor. Although at the inlet you get more benefit, you get more performance benefit that you would when you inject in the combustor. And I think Dr. Alex talked talked about this. So another way you could actually augment power is by supercharging the inlet of your compressor. Now what this simply implies is that you have a compressor or a fan at the inlet compressing air first before it enters the main compressor, basically. Another way you could do it is by overfiring, which is obviously in principle increasing your TET. Because if you look at the steady flow energy equation, if you have a reduction in mass flow, you can compensate that by an increase in the temperature difference, which is by increasing your TET. But then again, there's the issue of material limitations too. Just there's how much your hot end components can take, basically. So another method of doing that is by inlet air cooling, which is by far the most accepted or used method for augmenting power as a result of high ambient temperature. Okay, so this is just a breakdown of the turbine inlet air cooling techniques we have currently. So on this side, you have mechanical inlet air chilling. Here, the air is cooled using the refrigeration cycle, basically. Okay, so under this, you have two types. You have the mechanical chillers and the absorption chillers. So basically, I'll leave the mechanical chillers because we'll be spending the rest of the day talking about mechanical chillers. So for the absorption chillers, it's still the refrigeration that takes place, but instead of compressing a refrigerant, you'd use the exhaust gas temperature to generate that cooling effect, basically. Hello, is anybody asking a question? Okay, so basically that's what happens. So one advantage these have over these is that the parasitic power Sorry about that. I think I briefly went off. Okay, sorry about that. I think my PowerPoint restarted. Okay, so one of the advantage the absorption chillers have over the mechanical chiller is that you have very little parasitic power as compared to the mechanical chiller because you don't have a compressor operating in the system. The energy used to provide the cooling effect is practically free since it's just coming from the exhaust gas. But the disadvantage is that it is at least 30 to 40% more expensive in terms of capital cost. So another method of cooling the inlet air is evaporative cooling technologies, and we've got three types of the evaporative cooling technology. We have the wetted media, we have the inlet air fogging, and the wet compression. And the last, we have the thermal energy storage system. So basically, this is just you have a mechanical chiller arrangement, and you have a large tank that stores thermal energy. So when you have at the time where you have the cost of power is low, you generate a lot of cold water or ice and is stored in this thermal energy tank. And during the day, most times during the day, this energy stored is not used to provide the cooling effect. So it's just an additional step in the mechanical chilling process. But I would be dwelling, like I said, I'll be dwelling more on the mechanical chiller, so I wouldn't want to talk a whole lot on this. It's going to take a lot of time. Okay, I'll just talk a little on inlet air fogging because it's the most established evaporating cooling technology, and it's the cheapest of them all, basically, per ton of refrigeration. So for this technology, the mineralized water is, as you can see, it's atomized into fogs through nozzles at the inlet. So these nozzles are placed at the inlet, and you have a pump. You have a high pressure pump generating pressure, which is now atomized into fine mist of spray. Now what happens as the air comes in, the molecules or the droplets are evaporated into the air and thus provides the cooling effect and reduction in temperature, basically. So it's a pretty good system. It's cheap. A lot of people go for it. But basically, it has one major drawback, and that's what I want to talk about. Now, the problem with the inlet air fogging system is that it is the amount of cooling or the magnitude of cooling achieved is limited by wet bulb temperature. Okay? Or obviously relative humidity. So air has traditionally or normally air has the capacity to hold water, which is the measure of the relative humidity of the air. So the less the relative humidity, the more the capacity of air to hold water. The more the relative humidity, the less the capacity of air to hold water. So this is a psychometric chart which determines how much cooling you can get from the fogging system. So basically, let's consider a scenario where we have an ambient air coming into the compressor at 25 degrees centigrade. Okay, so and we have a relative humidity of 60%. So basically, this is how much cooling we can get for an ambient temperature of 25 degrees and a relative humidity of 60 degrees. This is how much we can ever get. We can't get more than this from the system, because what it means is that at 60% relative humidity, the air has just 40% space to hold water. Once it does that, this is the saturation line. Once it does that, water will start condensing. Once it gets to this saturation point, water starts condensing out of the air. And so no further cooling can be achieved. So if you draw a line down to the saturation point and trace it back down to the dry bulb temperature, you can see that for this, you can only cool down to about, I'd say 16 degrees from 25 degrees. You can't get more than this. Okay, if also look at, let's go to a smaller relative humidity. There's a relative humidity of 40%. You can see that the cooling achieved is a whole lot more because of the relative humidity or the wet bulb temperature. So that presents a major drawback in the performance of the inlet air fogging system. So it is limited by the wet bulb temperature. So let's say you want to design your system in such a way that you cool to 5 degrees. If your relative humidity is high, let's say it's at 80%, you can see you can only get about 4 degrees drop in temperature. So yeah, while it is cheap, it also has this drawback. So the fogging system, before you make a choice as to using the fogging system, you'd have to consider your ambient conditions, especially your relative humidity. If you're in an operating environment where the air is hot and humid, like obviously what we have here.
Yes, I'm not that.
like obviously what we have here, it's not really advisable to go for fogging system because there are days where relative humidity is as high as 90%. Practically get very little or no cooling. Now remember that you've got these nozzles installed at the inlet, which introduces an additional pressure drop. So you already, if it's not providing the cooling effect, then it's thermodynamic loss we don't want, basically. So inlet air fogging systems are ideal for ambient conditions where it is hot and dry. So you want to choose an inlet fogging system when you're at this point or lower, so you can achieve a much, significant drop in temperature. Because the more you can cool down, the more power augmentation you get out of the system. Okay, so I just want to just go through the mechanical chilling technique, because we'll be spending more time here, because ideally our ambient conditions favors this technology a whole lot. So basically the mechanical chilling technology just uses the vapor compression cycle. It's just like a refrigerator. It's not different from a refrigerator. It uses the same cycle. But in this case now, you have your inlet air cooling coils. You have a cooling coil installed at just downstream of your filter. Now, in most cases, you have a chilled water loop. So water comes from the vapor compression loop cold. It takes heat from the incoming air, thereby dropping the temperature. It goes back to, this is the evaporator. This here you have the evaporator. So it goes to the evaporator. You have a centrifugal compressor, compresses. So basically, this is in principle a heat exchanger here. Okay, so you have the cold water loop and you have the refrigerant loop. So once the refrigerant flows over this chilled water, it drops the temperature and it goes back again. Now, so the refrigerant in the vapor compression cycle takes the heat that has been collected from the inlet air from the chilled water. It goes through the compression process. Then the condenser takes the heat that was taken from the air and is dissipated via a heat sink. So you can either have a cooling tower, or it can either be water cooled or air cooled, depending on what you want your heat sink to be. So there are practically three loops here. I'm going to talk more on that. So basically that's how the mechanical chiller works. It's basically a refrigerator. So this is it. This is where you have your chiller coil. Somewhere around here you have your mechanical chiller producing the cooling effect for the chilled water. Okay, so what I want to walk us through is it's a mechanical, a techno-economic analysis carried out for GT13E2. What I wanted to find out was to see if it was economically viable, because the mechanical chiller technology is a proven technology. The major issue we have with this when it comes to power augmentation is the economics, because it's going to be different from one site to another. So basically, for this analysis, the site selected was Gerigu. Okay, so this here shows the ambient temperature for the whole year, maximum ambient temperature actually. daily maximum for the whole year for 2013. This shows the minimum ambient temperature for the whole year 2013. And this is the relative humidity profile for 2013. So it's just a summary of the parameters collected from a meteorological center, data center. Okay, so you can see the maximum recorded temperature for the year was about 37.76 degrees, which is quite high. And yet we had a minimum temperature of about 15 degrees C and an average, because what we do is we work with the average temperature for the year. Ideally, you'd want to carry out performance analysis or simulation for the GT at every single temperature, because it gives you a more detailed result, but that would be too much of work to be done. So I just worked with the average. I can see also the average relative humidity for the year, and this is quite important. As you can see, it's 73%. Like I said, if you were to install an inlet air fogging system on this site, you won't really get much out of it, because you can see humidity is high. Yes, it's hot. It's about 11 degrees deviation from ISO condition, but its humidity is quite high. So for this site, and I think for Port Harcourt, it was even worse. It was about 80% or so. So you can see why I said the inlet fogging systems won't really work properly for this operating condition we have here in the south. Okay, so there are three things that needs to be considered, or that was considered for this techno-economic analysis. First, I had to develop a gas turbine performance model or a simulation. I carried out a simulation for the Alstom GT13 into you have the performance, the gas turbine performance model, you have the chiller model, and you have the economic model. So the idea is to merge these three things together and see if it makes sense to enter into a project like this. So the model that was chosen, this is a variant that is it's of a higher class than what you have at AFAM anyways. So for this, there was a three variable inlet guide vent that allows wider range of turn down to as low as 50%. And you can see for this, it can go down. You can turn it down. You can operate at a part load of about 50%. And this is quite high compared to what I saw once at your plant at AFAM. It was really, really low. But this, the manufacturer is saying that, yes, you can go as low as 50% because of this three-stage of IGV. So you have a welded auto assembly that reduces cost and improves reliability. It had a 16-stage compressor incorporated from the proven Alstom GT26 low-pressure compressor, and an annular combustor using dry loop, NOx, AEV technology. We had a five-stage turbine thermal barrier coating, so that allows for higher turbine entry temperature. Okay, so this model was actually selected for this study. Okay, the next thing that was done was to create a model similar to this using a simulation tool. We had at Crownfield then. It's an in-house program. It's called TurboMatch. So basically, what the goal of this is to create a design point that is similar to what that is similar to the actual engine. So what we're trying to do is to replicate the actual engine on the tool. Because once we can get the design point performance, then we can model any other condition, whatever condition we want to. So in doing that, first you'll have to select the configuration of the engine, which is what you see here. You have the intake. Obviously, there'll be pressure rope. It takes into account the tool, or the software takes into account the intake losses, drop in temperature and pressure. You have the compressor. You have the pre-max. Pre-max is, you know, traditionally you bleed air from your compressor to provide cooling for hot air component like combustor liners and nozzle guide vane and the turbine blades. So this is just accounting for that bleed air, you know, for turbine cooling. And you have your burner, you have your turbine, and you have your nozzle. Okay, so after a lot of iterations, what I did was I kept turbine entry temperature fixed. All right, and you can do two things basically. You can use the turbine entry temperature as your handle, or you can use the mass fluid as your handle. As your handle, it's going to calculate the TET. If you use this, it's going to calculate the mass flow rate, basically. So this is turbo match results. After the series of iteration, I got the design points I was looking for. So you can see that it's a model that is about 99% similar to the actual engine. So for the power output, we had the same. There was no discrepancy or no deviation. For the thermal efficiency, it was 38. You got 37.7, which is almost the same. So basically, you can see the similarity with the actual engine. So that's what the goal was, okay? So once the design point performance is known, then the next step is to simulate the engine simulate the effect of increasing ambient temperature. How is it going to affect performance? How is it going to affect power output? How is it going to affect SFC, fuel flow, pressure ratio, and all of that? So the off-design performance simulation double match involves a matching procedure where component maps are joined together in the model and normal physics laws such as mass flow continuity, conservation of energy, speed laws, and gas laws are used to estimate performance of the engine at any desired condition. So basically, what we're trying to do is to predict how the engine will behave at whatever condition, like in this case, increasing ambient temperature. So next thing you do is to change it from design point mode to off design point mode. So basically, what was done in this program is what I did was I kept on increasing, you know, the ambient temperature from a minimum from ISO, which is about 15 degrees C to 39 degrees C. Okay, obviously taking into account the ISO deviation. So I had almost from 15 to 17 to 19. So I was just adding 2 degrees continuously until I got to 39 degrees C, while keeping turbine entry temperature constant. So this is the result of the design. It's just from the outputs of the simulation tool. You can actually download it into Excel and do all of these plots. So you can see the figure shows the effect of ambient temperature on the mass flow and power outputs, basically. So you can see that as the temperature, ambient temperature increased, you had a drop, obviously a drop in the mass flow. The same thing for your power outputs. Now for your fuel flow, we also had a reduction in the fuel flow, which I know some of you will say is a good thing, right? Can anybody tell me why we have this? Why do we have a drop in the first fear flow?
Hello, someone.
Yeah, go ahead.
Well, I think as the ambient temperature increases, your power output reduces. So basically, I think that maybe the unit is consuming maybe less gas because the combustion is not as high as it would be when the ambient temperature is low. I think you reduce combustion, output.
Yeah, that's a good one. Very close to what I want to hear. Anybody else?
Okay, let me try. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can. Go ahead.
Okay, I think for a fluid like air that has high temperature, you will need less fuel to increase the temperature because you're kind of burning air. So the amount of energy you will need to increase that air, the temperature of the air will be less. So assuming that the power output remains the same, it means that you will need less fuel to take the temperature of that air to that same temperature before. I don't know if you understand.
Okay, I get you. I get you basically. Anyway, you're all correct anyways. So so also you have an increase in specific fuel consumption, basically. And why is that? Why do you have an increase in specific fuel consumption? Now remember now that you're having a reduction in fuel flow, but then again your specific fuel consumption is going high, which is your you know what specific fuel consumption is. Or for industrial gas turbines, we use heat rate or thermal efficiency more than this. It's used a whole lot for aerogas turbines. Okay, let's go to thermal efficiency. You know, remember there was an increase in the fuel flow. You had it reducing, which you can say is a good thing. I'm burning less fuel, but your thermal efficiency is getting worse. Why is that? I'm spending less fuel, which is less money, but I'm having a reduction in thermal efficiency. Can anybody tell me why that is?
Maybe because you're getting less work at school.
Not exactly. You're doing less work output, but you know it's kind of an irony that I'm spending less, burning less fuel means I'm spending less money on fuel, but my thermal efficiency is not getting better. Okay, the reason for this is that you know mass flow, the drop. Remember that in the first diagram.
Is it that the compressor is doing more work? Graph.
Yeah, not exactly. Obviously, the compressor is doing more work, but yeah, that could fly. But the key thing here is the fact that, you know, when I started with the theory behind the loss of power or loss of performance, is the mass flow. Because you have reduction in density, definitely have reduction in mass flow, and mass flow has dominant effect. Now, while you have a reduction in fuel flow, which is, I mean, a good thing, you also have a reduction in power output, and as a result of reduction in mass flow, because mass flow has the dominant effect on power output. If you look at the calculation, you know, you did cycle calculation, it is mass flow times specific capacity times delta T. Now, delta T is kind of constant because for this simulation, TT was kept constant. Well, your mass flow have dropped, basically. So your power output will drop. So the drop in power output is overcompensating for the drop in fuel flow. So you have more drop, it's more significant on the mass flow, which obviously on the power output, than you have for the drop in fuel flow. So overall, you're going to have a reduction in your thermal efficiency. Okay? So yeah, while the both of them have dropped, you have more drop in mass flow, more drop in power than you have. It didn't drop at the same magnitude or with the same magnitude. So that's why it's like an irony. So at the end of the day, you'd see that power augmentation technique is more of increasing outputs. It's not the technology that you want to apply for just reduction in fuel flow. It's one that, because now if I do the reverse, I start cooling down. Let's say I'm at typical day in our farm, you are at 30 degrees and you have an inlet air cooling system. If I cool the temperature, let's say down to 15 degrees, while I will have an increase in power outputs and an increase or an improvement in thermal efficiency, I'm going to have an increase in fuel flow. Because remember that for a fixed fuel air ratio, the more mass flow you have, the more fuel you're going to have to burn to achieve that given or fixed air fuel ratio. So inlet air cooling, if you were to install an inlet air cooling, let's say mechanical chiller at your plant at our farm, you most likely see an increase in fuel consumption. But remember that you're going to spend more money on fuel, definitely. But the benefit of power is going to overcompensate for that, and overall you have increased profitability. So what it's basically saying is that if you are not, you don't want more power, you don't want to go in this direction, basically. Okay? Okay, so this is just a wrap-up of all the, you know, the results for the performance simulation. So you can see increasing T ambient, you have continuous reduction in the mass flow rate. You started at 624, you're doing 559. Have a reduction in the pressure ratio, obviously. TNT was kept constant. You can see reduction in the fuel flow, started at this and ended at this. Efficiency reduction because of what I've just explained. You have an increase in the specific fuel consumption, which is not what you want. You want a reduction in specific fuel consumption. So you can see that why you have a reduction in the fuel flow, but your specific fuel consumption is not, which is your fuel flow divided by your outputs. There's actually an increase. So you're not efficient, basically. So obviously you have a reduction in the shaft outputs. Okay, so that was for the determining the effect of ambient temperature on the performance of the G team. Now let's quickly look at the mechanical system, mechanical chiller system. Okay, so for the mechanical, some things you need to know about the chiller. Cooling is achieved via both sensible cooling and latent cooling. And this is one of the major advantages the mechanical chiller have over the inlet fogging system. Now, for sensible cooling, no water condensation. Remember that for the inlet fogging system, like I said, once it cools, this happens, this doesn't happen. Water condenses out and there's no longer a cooling effect. So for the mechanical chiller system, it is not affected by wet bulb temperature. It can cool. Even when there's condensation, it can still carry out further cooling. So for this system, you can cool up to, you can even cool below ISO conditions and even there's a possibility of even getting more power out than from the design point. So if the manufacturer is saying, okay, my turbine is rated 180 megawatts, you can cool it, if you cool it to, like, let's say 6 or 7 degrees, you can get up to 200 megawatts or 190 megawatts, basically. So the cooling performance is not affected by the relative humidity or, I'll say, wet bulb temperature. Now, another thing you need to know is that mechanical chillers need power to perform this cooling task, and that is a major drawback, and the power is parasitic. Okay, you can use as much as between 15% and 30% of recovered power for carrying out the mechanical chilling operation. So it's one of the major drawbacks of the mechanical chiller. But overall, you're going to have a net that is, let's say you recover 30 megawatts for this engine. I think that's what was recovered, 30 megawatts. Use about 5 megawatts to run your mechanical chiller, and the parasitic power comes from, basically 70% of this parasitic power comes from the compressor of the vapor compression loop. And you have pumps, you have the cold water pump, you have the the heat sink, the pump driving the working fluid to the heat sink. So it's just basically pumps, about 2 or 3 pumps in the system and the compressor, basically. So that's actually one thing you need to consider. Okay, the mechanical chiller system can be direct. Now, there is a system where the refrigerant loop or the vapor compressor loop passes through the inlet of your GT. This is not so common because there is a possibility of leakage if you have a leakage of refrigerant into your inlet air, then you have all sorts of problems, because remember that the air goes through compression and combustion. So you have a lot of issues. So most times we use water first. The vapor compression loop cools water, and then water goes to cool the inlet air, which is better. Okay, so when it is direct, you have the refrigerant cooling the incoming air, and indirect, you have a refrigerant used to cool water, which in turn cools the hot air. Okay, so the heat transfer sequence for the mechanical chiller, there are three types. There are three of those sequence. You have here, you have air coming through your filters. You have the coils installed just downstream of your filter, and it takes heat. That's the chilling water loop. It takes heat from the air, passes it to the refrigerant, which is working fluid in the vapor compression cycle. The refrigerant takes that heat to the condenser. The condenser passes that heat to a heat sink, which is your cooling tower. So heat transfer is done in three stages. Basically, it's done in the chilling water loop, the vapor compression loop, and the heat sink loop, basically. So for the chilled water loop, you have chilled water as the working fluid. Now, typically what happens here is you have a water antifreeze solution. The reason is that you don't want a situation where the water goes to a temperature where it starts freezing and it causes blockage in the piping. So what we do is you mix it with an antifreeze solution that reduces the freezing point drastically. So even if the temperature of water drops to, like, 0 degrees, it doesn't freeze out, it doesn't change phase and become solid. Because when that happens, then you won't have any more cooling taking place, because there will be no movement of the working fluid in that loop. So typically, a water glycol solution is used as the working fluid. Okay, so for the vapor compression loop, you have the refrigerant, maybe ammonia or chlorofluorocarbons. One of the chlorofluorocarbons are used, basically. So for the heat sink loop, depending on what you're using as your heat rejection, it could be either water cooled or air cooled. So depending on your operating environment, if there's no water around, you can the condenser but can be air cooled. If there's water around, then it can be cooled via a cooling tower. So some of the system considerations for the mechanical chiller, it's insertion loss. Now, so basically, once you install the chiller coils at the inlet of your GT, it places an obstruction to the inlet air, just like you'd have a delta P and a delta T across your filters. It imposes an additional pressure drop, which from a thermodynamic standpoint, we do not want that. But then again, we don't have a choice. So you'd want to make sure that the insertion losses are as low as possible, because we want to augment as much as we want. We want performance to be as high as possible. So it's one thing that if you're, let's say you're talking to a manufacturer, you'd want to know what this is, insertion losses are, and make sure that it is within acceptable limits. So another thing that you'd have to consider is that there is the possibility of ice formation at the bell mouth of your compressor. Now what happens is that once the air leaves the chiller coil towards the bell mouth of the compressor, there's an acceleration or an increase in velocity of the air, basically. And this is pure aerodynamics now. Remember now that the air has been cooled down, and so it's going to be saturated with water. So although there is a mist eliminator, you see that later, that tries to remove all the water condensed out, but you still, yes, kind of saturated, has water vapor in it. Now, if you have a further drop in temperature, because the acceleration will cause the enthalpy of the air to be converted to kinetic energy. Now, when that happens, now you have a further drop in temperature, which can, if it drops to the dew point, water will condense out. And at that low temperature, let's say you're cooling to 10 degrees, it can further bring the air temperature down, and there's a potential for condensate ice formation. And so now you now have a case of a solid going through, because ice is solid, it's no longer air, it's no longer water, and this can cause some damage to your compressor. So typically you would want to make sure that the desired drop in temperature is not too low. That's one of the disadvantages of going to too low a temperature, like let's say you're cooling to like 5 degrees. You know, you want to make sure that you have that you give some gap to ensure that this doesn't actually happen. Then another major consideration which I talked about is the parasitic power loss, which is the main disadvantage of the mechanical chiller, and that's between 10 and 30%. Okay, so what are the system components? Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. On your previous slide, speaking about ice formation, you said the ice formation results from the acceleration of air at the bell mouth of the compressor. So first of all, why is the air accelerated? Is it because why is it?
Yeah, you know, it is the action of your compressor, basically. You know, air doesn't, it come in at the entrance of the compressor, the speed of air is actually increased, basically. And when you have acceleration, this from an aerodynamic standpoint, you have a drop in temperature, basically. So if the design drop in temperature is low, let's say it's at 5 degrees, and you have further acceleration, remember that water is condensing out, and at 0 degrees, it starts freezing, basically. Okay, so it's like I said, it's a consideration, that it's a potential, basically. It's one that you have to take cognizance of. So when you're determining your delta T drop across the chiller coils, you have to give that. That's what I'm saying. You have to give that, you know, that leverage so that even when that acceleration occurs, and obviously there's a drop in temperature, you're not getting close to that freezing point. So you avoid the potential of this condensation.
Okay, so what I'm asking is this, this slide is trying to tell us some of the system impacts or systemic impacts of adding the mechanical chiller. So this my assumption is that this acceleration at the bell mouth is a result of the mechanical chiller. Because if it is not, it means that whether the mechanical chiller is there or not, there will be acceleration, which will cause.
No, there's acceleration. There's acceleration.
That is it because of the chiller.
No, not it's not because of the chiller, but you know,
which means this will happen normally now.
Yes, it will happen normally, basically.
Okay. So I'm trying to see if it happens normally, that there's acceleration without the chiller, which causes a drop in temperature without the chiller. I mean, there's still the potential for ice pollution without the chiller. So the chiller is not really doing anything to
There's not actually, because remember that if you don't have chiller, you have T ambient, let's say 30 degrees coming in. If there's a slight drop in temperature, it does nothing, basically. It's not good. The drop is not much. But, you know, you can, you know, the mechanical chiller gives you the potential to cool to whatever you want. You can cool it. You can literally cool the air to 2°C. And, you know, from a performance standpoint, you'll be getting increment in power. But what we're saying that you have to be careful so that, but imagine you now, the chiller is the one providing the cooling, and once cooling occurs, it's fine if it goes in as vapor. If there is vapor in the air, it's going. But remember that cooling effect brings about condensation. If you cool up beyond the sensible heat, you know, sensible cooling, you have latent cooling, and it brings about a change of phase. So you now start having water starts condensing out of the air. Now you have water literally going towards your compressor. If the temperature now drops to the point where that water starts freezing, you don't want ice to start forming. So yes, the chiller is what is causing, because without the chiller, you won't have cool air. You even most likely don't even have condensation in the first place.
So what I get from what you're saying is normally there's acceleration of air causes drop in temperature. But because T1 is T ambient, so drop in temperature due to acceleration may not be so bad to get to ice formation. So when you add the chiller, you're like, even dropping that temperature further, it may go towards 0 degrees Celsius.
Exactly.
Okay, so my second question is, I have three. Second question is, I was thinking acceleration increases the speed of the air, and when you increase the speed, there's supposed to be a drop in an increased speed, is also like a drop in static pressure or something.
Yeah, and you'd have a drop. It's also associated by a drop in temperature.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, so that's my second question. Then third question is, why this is live on YouTube?
Oh, that's Dr. Emma, actually.
Okay, this is, we have been broadcasted.
Me, actually, I'm being broadcasted.
Okay. No, I'm actually, because since I'm talking now, also part of the broadcast. Okay, no problem. Just to be clear why that was.
Yeah. I think it's for a YouTube channel, I think. Yeah, there are people also benefiting from this particular section too.
Okay, no problem. Thanks.
If you don't like it, we can. I can tell him to stop it.
No, he's okay. I just wanted to be sure, like, why what he was doing this.
All right.
Okay. All right. We're going online.
Okay. Moving forward, let's look at the components of the mechanical chiller system. So, you know, the mechanical chiller system is divided into three modules. You have the chiller coil module, you have the vapor compressor module, and you have the heat sink module. So there are equipment, I would say, in those modules that are helping the chiller perform this cooling operation. So for the chiller coil module, you have the chiller coils, which you can see here. And this is the supply header. And you have, you know, when it has taken, you can see characterized by a red line, when it has taken heat from the air, it goes, you know, to the vapor compression loop to dissipate that heat. Okay, so in this, you have the flow of air in this direction. Now, this is the chiller coils, typical this. Now, just after the chiller coils, you have the mist eliminator. Now, basically, what happens is when cooling takes place, some of the water vapor condenses out. And like I said, you don't really want water going into the compressor. So what the mist eliminator does is that it traps, you know, all the water condensate, and it has a drain system that removes this water, basically. All these things are embedded here, the chiller coil module, basically. Like I said, the working fluid is a typical water glycol solution. That is for the vapor compression module. You've got a traditional vapor compression cycle playing out here. So once the water comes in here, okay? The water comes in here. It flows like this. Comes in and flows over the tubes because it's a closed loop. Now, once that happens, it transfers the heat it has to the refrigerant. Typical ammonia can be used as a working fluid. Now, when that happens, it takes the heat and it comes in as a saturated liquid. It takes heat. Once it takes heat, it becomes a it becomes a saturated vapor because it has collected heat, causes a change of phase. Now, you have a compressor, which, like I said, consumes about 70% of the parasitic power of the system. So the compressor compresses the saturated vapor is now changed to superheated vapor. Okay, very hot. Now, that heat is now dissipated in the condenser. So the condenser is either you can see in this case, it is water cooled. So you have seawater coming in. This is for the other loop. So it rejects the heat to the heat sink. It goes through a receiver. Then now it now becomes it's now cooled. Once the temperature drops, it becomes a saturated vapor. Then it goes through an expansion valve which accelerates the flow, further dropping the temperature, and it goes in as a saturated liquid. And the cycle continues, basically. So that's for the vapor compression module. So you have four basic equipment here. You have the evaporator, you have the compressor, you have the condenser, and the expansion valve or geotopsin valve, whatever it's been used for the expansion.
I don't know why I understand about condensers that they are moving from gas to liquid. So why is it that the saturated vapor passes through the condenser and it is still a saturated vapor?
It's a superheated vapor, not saturated.
Okay, super. Because you said saturated and saturated.
Superheated, actually, superheated vapor. Okay, now you have very little. It's like purely gas now at this point. So this cooling occurs. You now have a mixture of gas and liquid.
That's saturated.
Yeah.
You initially said saturated cells.
Oh, okay, that's a mistake. Superheated, actually.
Saturated vapor at the receiver, then through the valve, now becomes saturated liquid.
Liquid, yes.
Then it becomes superheated vapor again, and then.
Yeah, exactly. So it just goes on in cycles. Probably happens in split seconds. You have this thing going around, and so it's just taking heat continuously. Okay, so for the working fluid, like I said, we can use ammonia or depending on what the chiller is using. So this is a standard refrigeration cycle. It's like a refrigerator, basically, the same way a refrigerator works. Okay, so the other module is the heat sink module. Here you have because that heat taken now from the first, it takes heat from the air, heat is transferred to the working fluid of the chilled water module. That heat is taken to the evaporator, from the evaporator is transferred to the condenser. You need to recheck the heat somewhere to a heat sink, something that can absorb all of that heat. And either you're rejecting to the air or you're rejecting to a very large body of water. Okay, so there are two types. And truth is your choice of the heat sink actually affects the performance. So basically what I did was during the modeling, I considered an air-cooled case and a water-cooled case. And clearly the performance for the water-cooled, the performance of the vapor compression and by extension, the overall COP was a whole lot better, basically, because water has a higher capacity to hold heat than air. But then again, if you're in an environment where you can't, you know, get a water source, you know, you might just have to live with that little drop in effectiveness. So it's either a cooling tower or a forced drought air cooler, basically. This is a cooling tower. You can see air comes in here. This is the header. It goes in. The water is it's breaking down into tiny droplets, so you can have greater heat rejection. It falls down. I'm sure a lot of you know about cooling towers, so it's just a typical cooling tower. It falls down to the source and it goes back in. So that's just the heat sink module, basically. So it's either water cooled or air cooled. Okay, so for the performance, I really wish there's a whole lot of calculations going on here, and I was thinking I'll have the time to go through it. It's quite interesting, you know. So what I did for this, for the performance of the chiller, I built a model on Excel. So there's a whole lot of key things to consider for the performance, okay? So I won't have the time to go through all of them or to go through the calculation. So I'll just show about five major, I'd say, key performance indicators for the chiller, the mechanical chiller. So the most important thing here is the cooling load. If you contact a company like our partners, Johnson Control, that you want to install a mechanical chiller for your plant, this is one of the first things they would want to determine, you know, is the amount of heat to be removed from the air in order to achieve a given inlet air temperature drop. So it is measured in tons of refrigeration or refrigeration tons, or to put it in a short form, RUT. You'd want to know what is the amount of RUT required. Now that is determined by, which a cooling load here is determined by the mass flow rate of air through your GT times the specific capacity of air times pressure drop across the chiller coils. Now that is determined by you. And this is the trickish part. It's in fact, there was a further recommendation for this. Because now, like I said, the technical part is not the issue with the mechanical chillers. It is the economics that is complex. Now, the question now is, how much temperature drop what is the optimum temperature drop rather, that gives me the best value for money? Now, remember that you know this already from obviously your size of the size of your gas turbine is going to affect this, the mass flow rate through it. Because remember, it's the mass of air we want to cool. Now that is already determined by the size of your gas turbine. You can't really do much about it. This is fixed. This now, let's say I have an incoming air at 25 degrees C. Should I cool to 10 degrees? Should I cool to 15 degrees? Should I cool to 20 degrees? All these will affect your cooling load, and your cooling load will consequently affect the cost, the capital cost. It's going to tell you how big. It basically tells you how big your mechanical chiller will be. Is it going to be small? Is it going to be big? You know? So it's a very, very important part. And this here, if you keep changing this, you're going to have the economics will keep changing, basically. So what we want to do, and it's the next phase for our performance, is to we want to create it. We started to talk about it. We want to create a model or a software that will be able to do this. So once you change this, it tells you what your economics is like. It tells you how it affects the performance of your chiller. So it's we want to create a system where the GT performance, the chiller performance, and the economic performance are all merged into one, basically. Because I tell people for inlet air cooling systems, you have a lot of techno-economic analysis to do to know what's best, because this technology is not small. You can spend as high as between $2 to $10 million doing this, basically. So you need to get it right. You need to optimize, you need to make sure that you're getting maximum value for money. So this cooling load is really quite important. Because that thing that you'd want to consider, what is the total parasitic power? And this young case, you're not designing, you're buying. You want to ask the manufacturer, what is the total parasitic power? Because remember that the higher the parasitic power, the less net power augmented you have, power augmentation you have. And obviously, if for instance, let's say you're augmenting a gross of 30 megawatts and your chiller system is consuming 10 megawatts, that is a whooping 30%. If it consumes 5 megawatts, you have an extra 5 megawatts to sell and make more money. So you want to keep this as low as possible. You want to keep it as low as possible. So another thing is the chiller coil effectiveness. It's something that is going to affect this in return. How effective am I transferring this heat? So basically, it is the ratio of actual cooling achieved to the maximum possible cooling. So it is T ambient minus TA, which is your drop in temperature, all over T ambient minus the temperature of your water coming into this chiller coil. What's the temperature? Because ideally you want this to be equal to this, but like we said, reversibility, that's not possible. But you want it to be as close to this as possible. So a good chiller coil design would have this tending to this, this tending to this. Okay, so it's going to mean that the amount of refrigerant flowing through the chiller coils, the working fluid is going to be less. And if it's less, it means I'm going to be using a smaller pump and chilled water pump to do the job. If I'm using a smaller chilled water pump, then it's going to have an effect. Yes, not too much, but it's going to have an effect on this. So you can see how these things play out. So, and this is one of the most important, the coefficient of performance. So the COP provides an estimation of how efficient energy is being used in the refrigeration system. Since it's always desirable to have the largest refrigeration capacity with the least power consumption, you want your refrigeration effectiveness to be high, and you want to achieve that with as low as possible power, okay? So it is this COP is more like the thermal efficiency of the mechanical chiller, although in this case is not expressed in percentages, can be greater than one. So the higher the COP you have, the better for you or the more efficient your system is. Another important thing you want to look at is the specific power consumption, SPC. Most mechanical chiller systems are rated according to their specific power consumption. The SPC is the ratio between the power consumed by the chiller to the refrigeration effect. I'm saying I am spending, you know, for in this case, like you're burning fuel in the gas turbine, and power is costing me money. How much benefit am I getting? You know, how much of that refrigeration effect, how much cooling is coming in for this power I'm spending? So that's your specific power consumption. So all these will tell you how efficient, if you can retrieve all of these from a manufacturer, it will tell you how efficient that chiller you are about to purchase is, basically.
So,
yeah, go ahead.
The specific power consumption, not the inverse of COP.
Yeah, in a way, you're right. Because it's like you're saying heat rate and thermal efficiency, basically.
So, okay.
So that the reason why you have this, you know, why we want to know this is that you can use it to compare different chiller systems. You know?
Okay.
You understand? You can say, yeah, because it's specific. You can use it to compare different sizes of chiller system, but remember, it's specific. You want to know, okay, what 1 kilowatt is giving me. You understand? So it's why it's similar to the COP, it's also good. So you can now compare different systems, basically.
Okay. Yeah, I think maybe it's more the input output size coefficient. COP is biased towards the output. You know, SPC is biased towards
exactly. The input. Exactly.
Okay. Just
nice one. Okay, so for the mechanical chiller performance, like I said, unfortunately, I can't go through that. These were the input parameters for estimation of the performance for doing those calculations. We have ambient air at 39 degrees, air mass flow rate. Well, this can be reduced. Like the way I built the model, we can actually, once you change this, start changing the whole calculation, basically. That's how I built it. So at 39 degrees, air mass flow rate at that, remember we did a simulation, and that's one of the reasons for that simulation. We want to know what the mass flow rate is at the T ambient, basically. Okay, and if you look at that simulation, it was this 562.38. Cold air temperature, okay, we want to drop it from this to this. Okay, that's a whole lot. And like I said earlier, it's going to have an effect on the cooling capacity, which is measured in tons of refrigeration. Okay, so we know the CP of water, specific capacity of cooling water is this, CP of water, glycol mixture, evaporating temperature. We actually selected this. This was selected because you have to select some of these input parameters. Okay, it is 2.2 minus 2.2. That's the evaporation temperature of the evaporator in the vapor compression loop. Cooling water temperature 25. This is for the heat sink. This is assuming, like I said, there were two cases, the water cooled case and the air cooled case, but because of time, I can't really bring in the air cooled case. Okay, so cooling water temperature, condenser temperature. Well, these are just the input parameters. Then we also consider the compressor isentropic efficiency of 0.8 because you have to account for losses in the system. Now, this is not the isentropic efficiency of your GT compressor. Or the compressor in the vapor compression loop, actually. So you have your mechanical transmission efficiency because you know it's actually driven by an electric motor. Okay, it's connected to an electric motor basically that provides the rotation. So there's a mechanical transmission efficiency was considered, and also an electric motor efficiency. So all these are just accounting for, you know, losses, making it the performance estimation to be as close to reality as possible, basically. So so this is the output parameter. So if the cooling load was estimated at 4,949.9 ton of refrigeration, the enthalpy of subcooled ammonia, there are a lot of thermodynamic calculation going on. The compressor ratio for the compressor was determined. The quality of liquid vapor ammonia was determined. This is actually the is a ratio of the vapor, the quality of vapor it's a saturated vapor. You want to know what the ratio of vapor to liquid is in that saturated vapor. It's quite important for determining the thermodynamic performance of the vapor compression cycle. And this was our refrigeration effect at our ROE. You can see it's 1,134 compressor exit temperature, heat of compression, heat generated by the compression process, refrigerant mass flow. Okay, so basically what I did was I created a preliminary performance first. I determined the preliminary performance and optimized it by subcooling. There are techniques to optimize this vapor compression cycle. Because of time, I couldn't go into all of that. You can see some of the ways it can be, but actually it's the job of the manufacturer of the chiller to do that, and it actually have been done basically. So the less of this you have, the smaller your compressor will be, and obviously by extension, the less the parasitic power. So this is a very important parameter in this chiller coil performance, water glycol mass flow rate. Also, you want this to be as small as possible too, because obviously you're going to have a smaller pump. Cooling water mass flow, condenser capacity, and you know, you can see the coefficient of performance 6.1, specific power consumption of 0.9 kilowatt per ton of refrigeration. So basically what this means is I'm spending 0.9 kilowatt for every ton of refrigeration, or every heat I extract from the air. So you know, like I said earlier, with this, you can use it to compare different systems with different sizes, basically. Okay, so I went ahead to look at the cooling effect on the GT1382 model. Like, okay, now we have an ambient of 39, we are cooling to 10 degrees, okay? So I didn't have to run these simulations again because I already had it. So I'm dropping the temperature here. You can see an increase in mass flow rates as the temperature goes down. Increase in pressure ratio, TT constant. You can see an increment in the fuel flow, like I said earlier. Despite that, there was an increment in thermal efficiency by about 3%. You have an improvement or a reduction in specific fuel consumption, and you can see shaft power increased to 211 megawatt. And this is a whopping 9 megawatt above ISO condition, because we cooled below ISO ambient temperature of 15 degrees. Okay, moving on to the economic model. So some of the considerations. So basically for the economic model, I considered an ambient temperature.
Sorry, Sammy, in the other slide, the values, are they just assumptions?
No, they are not. They're actually from simulations carried out. They're not assumptions, they're actual simulations. And the real engine will have very similar values like this.
Okay, what I'm asking is because I'm seeing C ambient 39 and I'm seeing shaft power 163.
Yeah.
And it has never happened. I mean, at this ambient, we're getting 156 if we
are so fortunate. Oh, I see. This model is not your model. It's actually a more recent model of GT13.
Oh, okay, okay.
So it's the ISO power is 202 megawatt actually for this. Okay, so for the economic analysis, what I did was I considered an ambient of 27 degrees because it that was the average we got at the beginning, okay? Ambient temperature throughout the year, because you need a like I said, it's a measure of central tendency, which is okay for analysis sake. But ideally, you would want to see what economics is like for every single temperature point, you know, which is going to make the job a whole lot cumbersome. And I didn't have that much time. Okay, so an ambient temperature of 27 selected, since it's the average ambient temperature calculated from the meteorological data of the selected location. The desired cold air temperature is 10 degrees. So we're cooling from 27 to 10 degrees. So that's about a 70 degree drop in temperature. The chiller capacity and overall parasitic power consumption will be based on selected temperature drop, obviously. Yeah, of, like I did for 27 to 10 degrees and for 27 to 15 degrees, basically. The economic analysis carried out considering a 1 year period, basically. So, this is the input parameters for the economic model. So you have a GT power output. So at 27 degrees from the simulations, this is what we have. We're getting 181.19 megawatts at 27 degrees. GT power output at 10 degrees is this. If you cool to 10 degrees, remember we got 211 megawatts. The total parasitic power demand by the chiller. Now, you can see it is 2723.15. That's 2.7 megawatts, basically. And this is because I had optimized my chiller performance. So incremental GT fuel flow. Now, as a result of cooling, you have an increase in fuel flow. So we want to know what that additional fuel flow is. It's quite important for the economic modeling. Because remember, we are working with incremental power, which is the power augmented. So we have to work with incremental fuel flow, okay? If, as a result of the chiller. Okay, so fuel cost was taken as, I don't know, this is, might be different from what you have. This is $0.06 per kilowatt hour. Electric energy price $0.11 per kilo. So I just had to convert all these to dollar per kilowatt hour. So I'm saying now that the chiller availability, I did some estimation here for availability, and I'm saying the chiller is availability is 96.16. I accounted for about 3 weeks of maintenance chiller, total chiller maintenance, because obviously you're going to do maintenance on the chiller system, and when you're doing maintenance, then it's not providing any cooling. Okay, so chiller installation cost as of 2004, it was, and this was the price, this was all I could get, $834 for every ton of refrigeration. Now, so basically what I did was to account for inflation. The model accounted for an inflation of 2.6%. But this was done in 2013, actually. So I had to account for inflation so that I can know, okay, this is what the current price would be. But it's a very reasonable, assumption. So now, if I'm cooling from 27 degrees, to 10 degrees, this is the ton of refrigeration. You can see that it's lower than when we cooled from 39 to 10 degrees, okay? So all these were imputed in the model to see, okay, let's see how profitable this is going to be, basically. So this is the calculation or the output that came out of this model. So we had the net power augmentation of 27 point net power augmentation. Now what we've done is the gross minus the parasitic power gives you your net power augmentation, which is what you can sell and make money. So your turn down chiller capacity. So when we moved from 39, it was 39 to 10, we had to use the average 27 to 10. This is your tone of registration. The chiller design capacity is this. So you can see deviation there. Total chiller capital cost. So if you multiply this times the cost per ton of refrigeration, you get, okay, say for this a mechanical chiller is going to cost us $5.1 million to install, okay? So annual O&M operations and maintenance costs came up to this, some calculations in the model, came up to $2.2 million. Annual fuel costs, incremental actually, came up to this. So now the total annual cost, we had to include a factor that considered all the charges on interest, tax, and all of that. So that amounted to about 700 and something thousand. So if you add all of this, this plus that, it gives you about 20 million. Now, the gross annual cost, okay, this is actually gross annual profit. Sorry, I should have corrected it, but I didn't. So this is gross, sorry about this. Gross annual profit, okay? So if you multiply your net power augmentation by your selling price of power, you can see you're getting a $25 million revenue. So if you do the net, you're making an extra a profit of about $4.5 million, which, well, it's good enough. And another important thing you want to look at again, okay, there are other capital budgeting technique that was used for this model, but I think this is quite important because the payback period is quite important because you are investing huge capital of this, which is the real cost of doing this is the opportunity foregone. So I would want to know, and now this is just speaking as an investor, I want to know how much is going to take me. How long is it going to take me for me to get this money back in profit? And from the estimation, it was about 1 year and about a month or so, which it's actually very good if you ask me. In fact, a payback period of 3 years is usually good because considering that this system has a life of between 20 and 25 years. Yeah, so the economic analysis showed that, yeah, going by all of these considerations, that it's a good investment. Now, this is not saying that it's good all the time. Like I said, the economic model is what determines, whether you're advising your management to go into this. And one major thing is this, you have to be running on base load, basically. I must add that at the end. You have to be running on base load. You have to be running for at least 7% of the time on base load. If you're always on part load, then why do you need extra power if you're not utilizing your full capacity? Okay? So these are some of the considerations you have to consider. So this bit is going to vary from one operating condition or even the site, the location of your power plant to plays an important role. I'll give you an instance. Let's say you're in a place where there's no water source. It's going to somehow affect the chiller, the mechanical chiller performance, because you'd have to go for an air cooled scenario. And I think that's the mistake I made. I would have just showed you side by side, so you see how better a water-cooled chiller outperforms the air-chilled cooler. So these are some of the things. There are lots of considerations. It's not really straightforward. There are lots of trade-off here and there. But it is the economics that drives the implementation of this. Remember that this is a retrofit. Another thing, again, is space. Do you have the space? Because most of these are done as retrofits. Although sometimes you can incorporate it in the design, in your plant design. Most times it's done as a retrofit. You have to start making some modifications to the inlet duct, There are lots of things to consider anyways. Okay, so that's about the techno-economic analysis for mechanical chillers. Like I said, it is for the ambient condition or the climatic condition we have in the south here. It's the best option to go for. Although the absorption chiller is going to do the same thing, but like I said, it's about 30 to 40% more expensive. But then again, you don't have the parasitic power. It's not there because you're just getting the free energy from the exhaust. So you might even want to consider do an analysis on the board and see, okay, which is going to pay me more. Remember now that once you use the absorption chiller, you're taking away your capability of going combined cycle in the future. So like I said, there are a lot of considerations to these things. Okay, so I'll just briefly, I don't think I even have much time. No, I'll just briefly run through Johnson control technology. Well, Entropy Tech has represent Johnson control in Nigeria here. So Johnson control, they are one of the biggest manufacturers. They're a very big company that into a whole lot of stuff, but this is like their gas stove. They have a segment for inlet air cooling. So they manufacture a wide range of chillers. Now, what makes Johnson Control unique is the fact that they manufacture their chillers themselves. Typically, other companies like Arana, you know, they even buy chillers from Johnson Control. But what they do, they just package it. Let's say you want a mechanical chiller, they buy the chiller separately. Some of them might make the coils, you know, they just bring all the components together and offer it as a turnkey solution. Yeah, I think that's the right word, turnkey solution. But for Johnson Control, they make their chillers, and the York chiller is one of the best out there in the world today. So one of the advantages they offer is that the cost of the cost per ton of refrigeration is they offer the cheapest, because obviously it's going to be cheaper since they make their own chillers. Another thing they do that is unique is the fact that they are the first to actually offer a modularized solution. They have a plug and play solution where you just bring it in. All you need to do is to connect to the water source, if it's water cool, or the heat sink module, and you're good to go. Okay, so modularized packages are gaining widespread acceptance today when it comes to inlet air chain systems. Okay, so they offer both absorption chillers and mechanical chillers, depending on your choice or depending on which is more profitable for you. So this is one of the, I think this is like, it's an award winner, basically, the YCB 2020 modularized solution. So this modularized chiller package system is practically optimized for the power sector. It's compact, self-contained, flexible, comes in a standard container module. So, I mean, site preparation is a whole lot. The installation time is a whole lot, you know, shorter because of this design. It's factory built and tested in dedicated JCI facility, and system modules with auxiliaries, electrical system and control, local and DCS control capability. So it's all in one. It comes as a single package, basically. So for this system, you know, we have a target capacity of about 2,400 tons of refrigeration, basically. This might be a little bit short of your GT13E2, but it depends, like I said, it depends on what temperature you want to bring it down. So you can design it in such that this is able to do the job, or you can connect this in series also. Yeah, that's possible. So this is an industry leading, when it comes to dollar per ton of refrigeration, this has the cheapest of all the systems offered out there. Okay, so they also have the package solutions where they come and they deliver this every component in the command. They put it in a package on site, basically. So this is another one too that, you know, is also a market mover. And another good thing is it can be designed bespoke for your particular application. Okay, so one of the, like I said, most of the time the TIAC is done as a retrofit. Okay, so some of the considerations are intake, it will have to be a modification on the intake. You can see an extra volume being added here, and this is where you have the chiller coils, retrofit of coils, eliminator, possible full replacement. You can actually even, might even need to change the whole of the dots. Now, another thing is you have to increase the structural load bearing capacity, because now you have an additional, you know, piece of hardware at the dock. So there will have to be some foundational work done on the inlet, this so that it can withstand increasing load. So these are some of the things that you'd want to consider, basically. Okay, so I've come to the end of this presentation. I wish I could have shown you guys more, but I'm happy to give you some materials. I'm happy to talk more about inlet air chilling. It's fine. So, are there any questions?
So,
Joshua, I think I lost you.
Can you hear me? No, I think it's Mr. Duribe wanted to say something.
Oh, okay. Duribe, go ahead.
No, not really, actually. Just a concern, because honestly, since yesterday and today, network has actually messed us up here in NAFAM.
Oh, sorry about
that. So we've not actually benefited so much from this.
Oh, sorry.
So it will not be like we are backcutting the training. Oh, that's okay, what okay. I want to chip in. Yeah, but as much as we can, the materials you send in, we look to into those ones.
Oh, okay. I'm going to send this across too. So I have my TCC.
Okay, sorry.